Harper Audio presents Days of Awe and Wonder, How to Be a Christian in the 21st Century by Marcus J. Borg, read by John Pruden. Foreword by Marianne Borg. For as long as there have been Christians, there has been considerable debate about what it means to be a Christian. From the authority of the Bible and the believability of its stories, to the meaning of Jesus, to what difference Christianity really makes, essential Christian ideas have evolved and been interpreted in various ways. Yet the 21st century has seen even more dramatic change for Christianity. Old assumptions about and images of God no longer hold. Christianity is no longer considered essential for salvation. It no longer provides an unambiguous moral compass. And the United States, a Christian country, is now the most religiously diverse country in the world. As W.B. Yeats wrote in Second Coming, "We are in a post-Christian era, and what rough beast, its hour come round at last, slouches towards Bethlehem to be born." So just how important is Christianity to the 21st century? What does it mean to follow Jesus across terrain that is both trampled and uncharted? Does being Christian really matter anymore? I suggest the angst among many Christians and the increasing number of nuns, N-O-N-E-S, on the religious affiliation line is good news, and it couldn't come at a more opportune time. As poet Yehuda Amichai writes, "From the place where we are right, flowers will never grow in the spring. The place where we are right is hard and trampled like a yard. But doubts and loves dig up the world like a mole, a plow." Our doubts and loves are shaking our foundations, readying the ground for new life. Christianity is being born again. Marcus Borg's journey reveals the fruit and labor of doubts and loves. In this collection of thoughts and ideas taken from a diversity of sources, from his dissertation written at age 27 to his final book written at age 70, you will find a companion for your doubts and loves. And you may just discover what it means to be a Christian in the 21st century. A quick word about Marcus. Marcus was asked to preach on a Sunday morning as part of a lecture weekend. A children's sermon preceding Marcus's featured two darling dog puppets. To introduce Marcus to their young audience, one puppet exclaimed how excited he was to hear him speak. The other dog puppet paused and then shyly asked, "Who is Marcus Borg?" Some of you know of Marcus Borg. Others of you are like the pup. Who is Marcus Borg? He is arguably one of the clearest, most accessible, insightful Jesus scholars and voices for Christianity in this century. He addressed many of our current questions and helped us fall in love with Christianity again, as if for the first time. This volume is an opportunity to meet Marcus. For some, it will be a chance to read Marcus again as if for the first time. And for others, it will truly be for the first time. I want to identify a few themes that await you in this book. The purpose of a book, suggests Thomas Merton, is to teach you how to think and not to do your thinking for you. As soon as any thought stimulates your mind or your heart, you can put the book down because your meditation has begun. And may I add, then pick this book up again. May it stimulate your mind and your heart. First, there is a more. Given all of life's ambiguities and the reality of impermanence and suffering, our existence is remarkable, wondrous. It evokes awe and amazement. We need to pay attention, really pay attention, lest we become blind to the awe and wonder that fills our days. Second, Jesus is significant, then and now, because he is one of us. He is the embodiment of human possibility. He shows us our capacity for knowing God, our capacity for courage, loving kindness, and doing justice. This is hopeful. Third, context matters. The first century world was fraught with economic injustices, oppressive social and political structures, and claims of monopoly on God. Jesus was deeply affected and concerned about the sufferings and inequities of his day, so much so that he dedicated his entire life to the welfare of others. Jesus was equally concerned that we come to realize the nature of and the reality that is God, in us, for us, beyond us. Our lives depend upon it. How are we to respond to the complexities of the context of our lives? What is real? How, then, shall we live? Fourth, there is a way of life that is sustainable. In brief, it is the way of compassion. Compassion is at the heart of all the great religious traditions. Each tradition is like a prism or a lens that gives us a distinctive perspective. We see only in part. Together, we can find the way. The lens of Christianity, clarified and refracted in the work of these pages, is a way of seeing that commands compassion, love of this wondrous life and all humanity, of all things seen and unseen, and the unceasing work for peace and justice. Jesus has been described as the face of God turned toward us. We see not only God in his life and even death, we see ourselves. We are given disclosures of the way, a lot to ponder. Every age should think of itself as the axial age, the pivotal time. Ours is no exception. We have unprecedented realms of knowledge and information at our disposal, medical advances, scientific discoveries, including the ubiquitous neutrino, the superhero of the subatomic particle world that prefers matter over antimatter. This is hopeful. Ours is a time of awe and wonder, of a magnitude not known before. A cautionary note. We also have an unprecedented capacity for self-destruction, not only of humanity, but also of the planet. The stakes have never been higher. What we do now matters. And here I return to Christianity. Why be a Christian in the 21st century? Because it gives us a vision and a hope and a way. The language of the New Testament talks about the kingdom of God, which is here now, which is what this world would be like if God was Lord and Caesar was not. The vision of Christianity for a just, sane, nonviolent world is not utopian. It is within our capacity, and such capacity requires that we take up the crucible of transformation. Transformation, individually and collectively, is the key ingredient for liberation. Without our participation in transformation and embodying lives of compassion, the kingdom of God will not come. It is up to us, and we are not alone. This volume will explore these themes and others. May the discoveries here give us hope, like flowers in the spring that emerge from a season that looks to some like death. Marcus Borg's doubts and loves plowed ground. His life and work led him to rediscover the heart of Christianity, for himself and for us. With new eyes and, yes, a new heart, being Christian in the 21st century can make the world a better place. As a benediction, I close with this passage from the Jewish Sabbath prayer book. Days pass, and the years vanish, and we walk sightless among miracles. Fill our eyes with seeing and our minds with knowing. Let there be moments when your presence, like lightning, illuminates the darkness in which we walk. Help us to see, wherever we gaze, that the bush burns unconsumed. And we, clay touched by God, will reach out for holiness and exclaim in wonder, "How filled with awe is this place." Marianne Borg, The Last Sunday of Epiphany, 2017. Become part of the unending conversation. The Marcus J. Borg Foundation Incorporated, www.marcusjborgfoundation.org. Chapter 1. Listening to the Spirit. Originally published in Jesus, A New Vision, 1987. When I was a young teacher in my mid-20s, an older colleague delighted in characterizing modern theology as flat-tire theology. All of the pneuma has gone out of it. The irony of his comment depended on the double meaning of pneuma, a Greek word meaning both air and spirit. I understood his point, but I wasn't sure I agreed with it. For me, modern theology was a joy, insightful, challenging, liberating. Though I still see modern theology as a treasure of great value for both church and culture, I also see that my colleague's statement was and is largely correct, not only about theology in general, but also about biblical scholarship and historical Jesus studies in particular. Within scholarly circles, Jesus' relationship to the world of spirit is seldom taken seriously. Attention is directed to what he said, and sometimes even to what he did, but seldom is attention paid to what he was. What Jesus was, historically speaking, was a spirit-filled person in the charismatic stream of Judaism. This is the key to understanding what he was like as a historical figure. In an important sense, all that he was, taught, and did flowed out of his own intimate experience of the world of spirit. The world of spirit. The notion of a world of spirit is a vague and difficult notion in the contemporary world. By it, I mean another dimension or layer or level of reality in addition to the visible world of our ordinary experience. This notion of another world, understood as actual, even though non-material, is quite alien to the modern way of thinking. The modern worldview, or picture of reality, sees reality as having essentially one dimension, the visible and material realm. Deeply ingrained in all of us who have grown up in modern Western culture, this worldview makes us skeptical about another reality. For most contemporary people, believing in another reality requires faith, understood as affirming that which on other grounds is doubtful. The world of spirit is not part of our taken-for-granted understanding of reality, not part of our worldview. But the notion of another reality, a world of spirit, was the common property of virtually every culture before ours, constituting what has been called the primordial tradition. Appearing in a multiplicity of cultural forms, indeed in virtually as many forms as there are cultures, it was almost a cultural universal, the human unanimity prior to the modern period. Essential to it are two claims. First, in addition to the visible material world disclosed to us by ordinary sense perception and modern science, there is another level of reality, a second world of non-material reality charged with energy and power. This basic division of reality into two levels can be spoken of in many ways, as the sacred and the profane, the holy or numinous and the mundane, God and this world, and so forth. What is most important is the notion of another level or levels of reality rather than any particular set of terms. Moreover, the other world, the world of spirit, is seen as more real than this world. Indeed, the other reality is the source or ground of this world. Second, and very important, the other world is not simply an article of belief, but an element of experience. That is, the notion of another reality does not have its origin in pre-scientific speculation about the origin of things, primal anxiety about death or the need for protection, but is grounded in the religious experience of humankind. It is not merely believed in, but known. To put this second claim somewhat differently, the world of spirit and the world of ordinary experience are seen as not completely separate, but as intersecting at a number of points. Many cultures speak of a particular place as the navel of the earth, the umbilical cord connecting the two worlds. Some cultures speak of the two worlds intersecting in particular historical events, but it is especially in the experience of individuals that the other world is known. In every culture known to us, there are men and women who experience union or communion with the world of spirit, either entering it or experiencing it coming upon them. Those who experience it frequently and vividly.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.